Hello, and welcome back to my series on learning commands in Minecraft. My name is slicedlime, and today we're going to dive deeper into the execute command we started exploring a couple of parts ago. If you've followed along with the series this far, you'll now know how to identify and set blocks and block states, how to select entities, and how to set scores for them in a scoreboard. We can combine that with the execute command we learned about, using execute at to move where we run commands and execute as to change who runs the command. There's a third category of execute subcommands that we'll look at today, conditionals. A conditional execute doesn't change anything about how the command is executed, it simply decides if it should execute or not. All conditional execute subcommands look the same, execute if or unless followed by some condition. The if and unless forms are exact opposites of each other. If some condition would pass when used with execute if, it will fail when used with execute unless. Let's look at our first example to make things more clear. That is execute if block, or if you'd prefer, execute unless block. We use execute if block to execute commands only if we find a certain type of block at a given position. Let's try it out. Remember that execute commands are followed by run and then another command. Execute if block, tilde, tilde negative 1, tilde, gold block, run, give, at s, diamond. Pretty straightforward, but let's walk through it. Execute a command if the block at tilde, tilde negative 1, tilde, that is, the block we're standing on, is a gold block. The command to execute is to give the entity executing the command, that is, myself, a diamond. Great! Running that command in a few different places confirms that I do indeed only get a diamond if I'm standing on a gold block. We can also use the inverse form. Execute unless block, tilde, tilde negative 1, tilde, gold block, run, give, at s, diamond. That one gives me a diamond everywhere except on top of gold blocks, which is what we expected, the exact opposite of the execute if command. We can also combine this with the other execute subcommands we learned last time. Let's say Piggo here is my partner in crime. I get diamonds if he is on top of gold. We can use execute at to move where the command is run, which then also changes the reference point for our relative coordinates in execute if block. Execute at e type equals pig, tag equals Piggo, if block, tilde tilde negative 1, tilde gold block, run, give at s diamond. We move the execution to be where Piggo is. Check the block one block below, and if that is a gold block, then give at s a diamond. And since we only change the position of the command, not who runs it, I still get the diamond. Thanks, Piggo! We can be more precise if we want here. Execute if block, tilde, tilde negative 1, tilde, composter. Run, say, GUI. That matches all composters, regardless of the block state. We can also match the block state if we want, though. Execute if block, tilde, tilde negative 1, tilde, composter, level equals 1. Run, say, not much. Any block properties that you don't specify will match no matter what they happen to be, but all the ones you do specify must match exactly. If we want to check more than one block, we can even chain multiple execute if block checks together. Execute if block, tilde, tilde negative 1, tilde, gold block. If block, tilde, tilde 2, tilde, diamond block. Run, say, I'm rich! This checks the block below me for a gold block, then the block above me for a diamond block, and only runs the say command if both of those were the blocks we wanted. As you can see, our execute commands are starting to get quite long, but they're built up out of smaller pieces that you now know how to read. This is how large and complex commands get built up, and piece by piece, you'll keep learning these building blocks. Hey, if you've found this video helpful this far, please go ahead and give a diamond to the like button. It really does help the video and the channel. Thank you. We could keep adding more execute if block statements this way, but it's very quickly going to become extremely long. What if we want to test an area, let's say a 3x3x3 cube? That doesn't sound so large, but that's 27 blocks we need to test, so that's 27 consecutive execute if block checks. Not very fun to write out, and even less fun to try to debug if you accidentally introduced a typo somewhere. We need something better for that case. That's our next conditional. Execute if blocks. That's blocks, plural. Sounds very similar, but does something rather different. Execute if blocks tilde negative 1 tilde negative 1 tilde negative 1 tilde 1 tilde 1 tilde 1 tilde 4 tilde negative 1 tilde 4 all run give at s apple. That was a lot of numbers. What is all that about? Well, one easy way to think of it is that execute if blocks is a conditional counterpart to the clone command. The coordinates work the same way. First the coordinates of two corners of a source volume, then the coordinates to the lower corner of a destination volume. This will check the blocks in the source volume against the destination volume and continue the execution if they all match. In this case, we checked two volumes using relative coordinates, but it's perhaps more common to use this command with a template placed somewhere in the world, referenced with absolute coordinates, against some relative coordinates. The last parameter, where we specified all, is called the scan mode. This can be either all or masked. When we ran it with all, it checked every single block. If you run it with masked, it will instead ignore any error blocks in the source volume and accept whatever block is there in the destination volume for those. One more thing to keep in mind here is that as opposed to execute if block, when using execute if blocks, all the block states are compared exactly. So all the block states must be exactly the same in both areas for the match to succeed. Let's move on to the next conditional execute form. We checked for blocks, so the next logical step would be to check for entities, right? That is exactly what execute if entity does. Or execute unless entity, of course, if you want to check for the absence of an entity. The format is simply execute if entity followed by a selector. Let's try! Execute if entity at e type equals pig, tag equals pigo, run set block tilde tilde negative 1 tilde diamond block. So if there is a pig in the world who has the tag pigo, set a diamond block at the location tilde tilde negative 1 tilde, which is beneath my feet. Again, the conditional only checks if the condition is true or not. I am still executing the command, and it still happens where I'm standing, so the block ends up beneath my feet. This might seem very similar to another execute form. Execute s at e type equals pig, tag equals pigo, run, say hi. In practice, the two are sometimes interchangeable and indistinguishable, but sometimes very, very different. To illustrate, we need to use something else than pigo. Let's take our friends the villagers here to help us out. Execute if entity at e type equals villager, run summon bat. Okay, works as expected, we get a bat at my location. Execute s at e type equals villager, run summon bat. I can't lie, that's a pretty cool effect, but that's way more than one bat. In fact, every single loaded villager in the world just ran a summon command at my feet, summoning a bat. If we were to use at s in that command, it would also end up even more different, since in the case of execute if, I am still running the command, but with execute s, the villagers are the ones running the commands. There is also a different way to use these conditionals. If you use an execute conditional without a following run command, that is, unexpectedly, a valid command. So, what does it do? It simply checks and in the case of execute if entity also gives you back a count of the matching entities. So if you're simply wondering how many entities match some selector, you can use execute if entity to get that count. Execute if entity at e type equals villager. Running that without any following run clause tells us how many villagers we have loaded in this world. We could of course also use the fancy score selector we learned in the last episode to check for entities here. Execute if entity at e scores equals pig in s equals 1 or more. This checks if there's anyone who has a pig in s score of 1 or more, which is great, but it only finds pigo. What happened to the god of pigs from last episode? Let's turn on the sidebar display for the scoreboard again, since we'll need it as an example. Scoreboard objectives, set display, sidebar, pigginess. The score still exists, so why didn't it count for our execute if entity command? Well, an entity selector can only find entities, and the god of pigs is fake. I'm sorry, Pigo, it's true. So if we're using fake players for scoreboard entries, we need a better way to check them. That's where our last conditional for the day comes in. Execute if score. This is some pretty complex forms, but let's start with a simple one. Execute if score, the god of pigs, pigginess matches one or more, run, say, very fake. So execute if score, then a name, but this time it can be a fake name. Because we're just checking if the score has a value, we don't need it to be an entity, so the fake player works here. If we wanted to, we could also use a selector here. After the name, we have the ID of a scoreboard, in this case the pigginess scoreboard we created last time, and then the word matches followed by a range, in this case we're testing the score against one or more. This matches form is the simplest and the most common form of the execute if score conditional. Of course, we can also test if the score doesn't match by using execute unless score. This is not all we can do with this one though. There's a more complex form used to compare two scores against each other. That starts out the same way, execute if score, name, and scoreboard ID. But then instead of matches, we use a comparison operator. The available ones are less than or equals, greater than or equals, and greater than. This is followed by another name, or selector, and another scoreboard ID. So we can compare the scores of two different entities in two different scoreboards, or the same entity in two different scoreboards, or an entity against a fake player in the same scoreboard. There are lots of options available for us here. Anyway, let's look at an example. Execute if score, the god of pigs, pigness, greater than, at e, type equals pig, tag equals pigo, limit equals 1, pigness. Run, say, pigo believes. We've been selecting pigo for a while now, but now we're selecting with limit equals 1. Why is that? Well, because since execute if score needs to compare two scores, it needs to know exactly which entity to compare. So it needs exactly one entity here. And that's why we add limit equals 1 to make sure that we only get one result. If we would try to run the command without limit equals 1, the game would tell us our selector generates too many results. As usual, when it comes to these execute subcommands, there are more forms of execute if or unless that we haven't covered yet and that we'll get back to later in the series. For now, these forms are absolutely enough to be able to make some quite sophisticated commands while checking the state of many things in the world. And that's where we wrap up things for this time. My name is slicedlime, thank you for learning commands with me. Now it's time for practice, so get the companion map and do the exercises there, and feel free to join my Discord where we have a channel for learning commands. I'll see you next time.